Can people hear me?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Good. For a moment there, I thought, Houston, we have a problem, but no, we're all right. Yes, everybody can hear me. Lovely. Considering the topic we're doing and the history of New York City, the original Harlem is online. Welcome back. Hi, Jill. And for those of you considering the topic of today and next week's webinar, I thought a little bit of Billie Holiday would be most suitable as our background music to start with, and there she is. Greetings to David from Stratford-upon-Avon, the original Stratford. From a city of one playwright, and we're going to be presenting you our city playwright. Song there. Hello, Karen. Those of you in Pittsburgh who are regular Pitt supporters might remember we did a play a few years ago called For the Tree to Drop by the wonderful Lissa Brennan, and she took the title from that song. Something about Billie Holiday's voice that you just can't not listen to. It's extraordinary. Hello, Jackie. Welcome. Hello, James. It would appear that from the newspapers all around the world, there seems to be a heat wave going on. But there's no sign of it slackening off here in Pittsburgh. It's ridiculously hot. Unseasonable weather, as they might say. I mean, I know it's summer, but, you know, a joke's a joke. This is very, very hot. Even Ireland has been experiencing sunshine and warmth, which in the summer is very odd because normally it just rains all the time. The old principle of why is Ireland so green? Because it never stops raining. Actually, it's not true. Actually, it can be quite beautiful. We'll have much more information about this, but as I say, this week and next week we have our guest, Wali Jamal, talking about August Wilson. And as we come over the next few weeks, we're going to have other guests. We have a guest from Ireland coming on for two programs, Aoife Spillane Hinks. She was with us, she's actually American, but she lives in Dublin, and she came over to direct three shows for us in the past, including The Waiting for Godot that we did. and the John B. Keane play Sharon's Grave, and she also directed Our Class as well. She's going to be talking, or she's going to be discussing with me. We're going to do a sort of a back and forth discussion about John Millington Synge, who wrote Playboy, The Western World, and various other plays. So we'll be chatting about Irish writing with her in, I think, 3 or 4 weeks' time. We're going to do a 3-webinar session analyzing the play King Lear. So we've got a nice variety of things leading up. And of course, we're always interested to hear what you want us to talk about. It's not just what I think, it's what you'd like to hear as well. So if you have any thoughts on plays or matters of theater that you'd like us to look at in these webinars, please, please, please just email us. We'll do our very best. Hello, Mary Lou. What do you do when not have sound? I have no idea what that question actually refers to. Can you clarify? Hello, Nanette and team. Yes, Kel, yeah, we're delighted to be doing this on August Wilson. I mean, you know, we deal in classic theater, classic drama, and August Wilson, apart from being, you know, the Pittsburgh playwright, is a modern, his plays, they are modern classics and fall very much into that bracket of true of its time and for all time. So it's only right we do it, and also that we have Wally, and I'll explain why we've invited Wally to do this in a few moments. Oh yes, there was one other thing that we have coming up. Those of you who've been with us may remember Kathleen Dixon talking about the Algonquin Circle and Dorothy Parker. She's an authority on literary circles. And so in, I think, 2 weeks' time, something like that, in 2 weeks' time, she's going to be doing a webinar with me on the famous Irish literary circle, which was the Irish literary revival group, with W.B. Yeats and Lady Gregory and George Martin and George Moore and others. And that grouping was what led to the formation of the Abbey Theatre. And so we'll be getting the background from her, and we'll be discussing that evolution from the ideas of some poets and writers into what became the world's first national theater, which was the Abbey in Dublin. So that's coming up in 2 weeks' time as well. We do try to keep ringing the changes and give you a nice variety to listen to every Friday. Hello from sunny Toronto. John, you see, that's what I'm saying. This summer is getting to be very suspicious. Far too much sun and far too much heat. Not that I'm complaining about the sun, it's the heat that gets to me. You know, when you get old like me, the heat is a bit of a burden. Hello, Kathy from Ohio. Hello, Lonnie. Rita, Moon Township is very, very exotic. I mean, it's one step from the airport, and that means one step from everywhere in the world. How can you possibly suggest that Moon is not a romantic or exotic location? just, I'm full of imagination. Hello, Hazel. We're glad you're here with us as well. Syllabus comes and syllabus goes, but PICT webinar is here forever. Hi, Mimi. No, no, Hazel. We have these things are sent to try us. Rita, we're all friends here, and the more friends that we introduce and bring to this little circle and make it bigger and bigger, and that circle is going all the way around the world as well. So, yeah, welcome. And if it's your first time here, really welcome, and we hope you stay with us for the future. There you are, Patricia, down the street in East End Avenue. And for those of you who don't know it, I live on East End Avenue, which is where my house is, which is where I'm coming from. One of the nicest streets in Pittsburgh. I would say that, of course. But the trees on this street are stunning. They're amazing. Yes, don't worry, Susan. The music is going in about now, because it's time for me to make a start on this. So we will say goodbye to Billie Holiday until next week, and we will make a start on today's program. Now, before we begin, today's program actually has been sponsored because, as I always tell you, you know, we don't do these for nothing. It costs money to put these things together, and we're always looking for help and sponsorship. So we're inviting people to sponsor these programs, and today's has been sponsored by an anonymous donor. To anonymous donor, thank you very, very much indeed for sponsoring this. And for all of you who are watching, you can also silently say thank you to the sponsor as well, because we are here today courtesy of that anonymous donor. You can do the same. You can sponsor one of these as well. Don't feel shy about that. You know, don't say, oh, no, I couldn't possibly do it. Of course you can. And in fact, you could do it as a group. If you've got a family or if you've got a few friends who'd like to sponsor the program, you can contact us. You can get to us by email at picttheatre.org, or you can go onto the website. You'll find that information. Contact our general manager, Catherine, and you can sponsor one of these programs. It's very easy, and it's not expensive, but we would appreciate it if you do. Just like we want you to help us out with donations, sponsorship is a big thing. We've already got some sponsors for some of the programs coming up, including the Shakespeare's, and we'll tell you more about that as we come closer to them. So today, Wilson in August, rather a clever title when you think about it. So we are today celebrating the life and works of one of Pittsburgh's most beloved playwrights, if not the most, presented by one of Pittsburgh's finest actors. Wali Jamal, who is presenting this, is a born and bred Pittsburgher. He spent more than 20 years performing on the very numerous stages of his native city. He's worked in all forms of drama, doing plays, musicals, voice work, and with most of the principal companies. Being a native Pittsburgher, Wally has become steeped in the history of Pittsburgh, and particularly in that of the African-American community and its heritage within the city. Pittsburgh has a huge African-American heritage. Pittsburgh was one of the great jazz centers of America, the Hill District, where August Wilson was from, and I'm sure Wally may address that. But Wally has become something of an expert on this whole range of topics concerning Pittsburgh and its African-American heritage. And that is why the works of August Wilson have become so particularly engaging to him. We actually believe that Wali Jamal is the only actor in the world to have performed in all 10 plays in August Wilson's American century cycle. Also, in addition to that, he has a one-man show called How I Learned What I Learned, which earned him in 2018 the Pittsburgh Performer of the Year from the Post-Gazette. So we have somebody who is an authority. So I'm asking Willie to join us now, Wally to join us now and to take over, and it's yours. Welcome. Okay, Wally, we have a problem. We can't hear you. We want to double check that your mic is not muted. Sorry about this, everybody, but we sometimes hit these little technical problems. We'll make sure that Wally's mic is actually working and that it's not another or a different problem.
Try again, Wally.
Actually, we're trying to, I think we're having a problem contacting. Wally, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Oh, that's good. We can hear you now. We couldn't hear you at all. Your mic seems to have been muted. But anyway, off you go again. It's all yours.
All right. Well, thank you. Once again, Pittsburgh Irish and Classical. Thank you, Alan. Thank you, Catherine, for all your help on this webinar, ninja stuff. This is so, I'm old, you know. So, but anyway, August Wilson and how his work, his life has been such a big impact on mine. And I'll tell you how I first got involved with the work of August Wilson. It was 1998, where I was auditioning for a play, my very first play. I hadn't taken drama in school or anything, and I had been doing stand-up comedy here in the city for like 12 years before I got on the theater stage here in Pittsburgh. And it was with Country Repertory Theater that I auditioned, just a walk on, and walked out with the lead role. And crazy. And during the rehearsal period, I had told the dearly departed Dr. Audrey Watson Lilly, Vernell Lilly, that I had never been in a play, or for that matter, never even been to a play. So it just so happened that they were getting ready to go to Baltimore to a theater to watch August Wilson's play, Jitney. And so they snatched me up, took me with them. And I sat there between Dr. Lilly and our director, Eileen Morris. And as the play was going on, they were teaching me blocking 101. See, he's talking, he's sweeping. See that? He's sweeping and he's talking. He's always gonna wind up at that same spot every night, every show. And I'm like, okay, so I'm learning, crash course. Now, mind you, I had the lead role in this play that they cast me in. And just watching that play had impacted my life, but not as much as I thought August Wilson's work would, because just 2 months later, And I had been collaborating with Mr. Mark Clayton Southers, and this was pre-Pittsburgh Playwrights Theater. He had a thing going on at his house called the August Wilson Reading Roundtable, where playwrights from Pittsburgh and elsewhere would come and bring out their plays, and we would read their plays. And we happened to read August Wilson's plays here and there. And so in March of 1999, we were reading Jitney, and Mark had gotten a call from August Wilson saying that he would like to sit in with the reading with us, reading Jitney. And mind you, I still have not felt the full gravity of who this guy was. And it just that he wrote the play, because I'm green to theater, even though I'm in my 30s. And he sat there and he read the part of the most cantankerous person in the play, this character named Turnbull. I played Fielding. He was a drunk, and they were jitneys here in Pittsburgh. And it is just so familiar to me. And the people, the characters in the play talked like my mom, my aunts and uncles. And it just felt like it embraced me instead of me having to embrace it. I mean, it equally did that. It embraced me as much as I embraced it. And August was incredible. He was a very soft-spoken man, to tell you the truth, even though he wrote the one-man show. But he was an incredible actor. He heard these voices and they came right out of him. And so we had the dearly departed Alice T. Carter from the Tribune Review in attendance, and she wrote a nice little section in the Tribune Review about it. And my first few months in theater, I'm hanging out and reading a play with August Wilson, and we had a break. And August and I at the time were the only cigarette smokers there, and it was March and it was cold. So we go out on Mark Southern's porch, and it's the wind's blowing all like that, and we're smoking our cigarettes, stomping our feet. And so I'm like, ask him, don't ask him anything stupid. You know, so, you know, that voice in your head, you know. So I said, well, do you have any advice for an up and coming playwright? And he said to me, write what you know. I said, write what you know. That's it. He said, write what you know. And if you don't know and you still want to write about it, research. And I said to myself, I know Black history. So I got to work putting together this, my first play. And it was a Black history play. And it was about a man named Robert Smalls, who during the Civil War became a hero, because during the Civil War, he was a slave on a Confederate ship. And he stole the ship, got his family, his friends and their families off to safety, turned the ship over to the Union blockaders. They in turn commissioned him as a lieutenant, put him back on that same boat, sent him back into service for the Union, where he served meritoriously, served on the South Carolina State Legislature. He was the collector of customs in Charleston. He was the commander in chief of the South Carolina State Militia and served term after term after term as a congressman in the United States Congress. So yeah, that was a grave undertaking. But just that encounter with August Wilson, it encouraged me. It made me less afraid to think big. So it was really awesome. And so time went on, and next thing you know, we're doing Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, a Pittsburgh Playwrights production. The very first full-length Black production, August Wilson production. Pittsburgh Playwrights had gone on to do all 10 August Wilson plays in their succession that they played on Broadway. Hey, it all counts. But we did that, and I read the role and played the role of Toledo. And in the role, I mean, these guys, there's these four guys in this little band, and Ma Rainey, she's this, you know, blues singer, she's great, big star, top of the charts. And these four guys were her, you know, studio musicians. And the play was, it was mostly about them. And these four guys, there was three of them who were kind of older, and this one young firebrand upstart. And of those three, I played one of those three, the only one who could read. His character was Toledo. And I got to tell you, while we're in the process of this, I'm realizing that this guy's, he's much older than I am. So I did what I could to old myself up. Now, I got to tell you, we just did it a couple of years ago and didn't have to do anything to old me up. But back to Mulroney, the first one. We're doing the play, and the playwright from Country Repertory Theater, Mr. Rob Penny, beloved playwright, he had passed away. This is 2003. And he came in town for the funeral, and he came to see our show. So we're all abuzz in the background, in the backstage, and he's here. Well, what are we gonna do? We're all scared, you know, beyond. We did great, though. And my character got killed in the very last moment of the play. And this director was so adept at visual effect that once I died, I'm laying there, and I had to die with my eyes open. And while I'm laying there with my eyes open, everything goes black except for this pin red spotlight on me. And it's a really creepy, lurid effect. But the thing was, I knew where August Wilson was sitting. And I made sure I laid there with my eyes open, looking right at him. And he was sitting there like this, like. And there was dust, you know, theaters. There was dust, all this stuff falling into my eyes. I did not blink. I just laid there and tears streamed out, but I did not blink. And then everything went black. The lights come up. We took our curtain call. And when we were done with our curtain call, he got out of his seat. He came down to the stage and he shook my hand. And he said, "You were good. You were good." And that was enough for me, for August Wilson, to say you were good in his play. Oh, my goodness. So that was a moment. That was a moment. And that was 2003, Pittsburgh Playwright's very first August Wilson production. And we went on from there. We did Joe Turner's Come and Gone. And I tell you what, I did all 10 of the plays. And I didn't really set out to do all 10, just like I'm sure August didn't set out to write 10 plays, each one taking place in a different decade of the 20th century. And I got to tell you, doing all these plays, it feels, I don't know, I would compare it to what a Shakespearean actor would feel doing the complete works of the Bard. And performing it, actually performing it, on performing two of his plays on the ground on which he actually grew up. Now that, to me, was like performing at Stratford-on-Avon. In the backyard, which in the play Seven Guitars, he actually wrote it to be in the backyard of the house he grew up in. And there we were. And there were some things that happened that it just felt like the spirit of August made things work. Where one night it was raining. And on this one night when it was raining, it was actually appropriate. It was actually great that it did rain because of the dramatic moment that was going on. I can't even think of it at the time. But and we actually performed Gem of the Ocean at the fictitious place in a recurring theme in his book where the character Aunt Esther. She is supposed to live in the house with the red door at 1839 Wiley Avenue. And at the time that we did it, it was an empty lot. It was a church sitting there. And it's an empty lot. So Mark Southers is insanely genius. He saw this. And we built this stage on this empty lot on a slope outside. And we made it happen. the first night, there was a full moon. It was a beautiful night. The clouds were just, it just added to the ambiance of the evening. It was just getting at dusk, you know, and the play was starting. And there was just so much magic in performing it right there at that place. When we would say, this is 1839 Wiley, we said it and we meant it. And it was just no other actors in the world, no theater company in the world can say that had ever done Gem of the Ocean can say that they performed it at 1839 Wiley Avenue. And I tell you what, that is one of my absolute favorites of the 10 plays. Because I play Caesar and he's old meanie, he's very mean and he's misunderstood. And when you play a character who is perceived to be the bad guy, you justify. You think of reasons that you can rationalize his behavior that kind of is off-putting to your audience. And that's how you become the character. That's how you, not trying to teach acting, but with August Wilson's characters, they are so based in reality. Like the character Caesar was based on a cop who actually existed in the Hill District. He was a cop by the name of Oliver Mason. They called him Two Gun Mason. And there was this historian here, Frank Bolden. He used to work for the Pittsburgh Courier, and he quoted Ollie Mason by saying, if they wasn't doing wrong, he wouldn't get shot. And this cop, I mean, he would shoot you just as quick as say you're under arrest, but at the same time, he would take bike parts, he would put bikes together to give to the little kids so they wouldn't be out stealing nobody's bike, so he wouldn't have to shoot them. See, he rationalized. So you understand what I'm saying. And there's characters, there's very rich, rich characters. And the thing that makes me equate the works of August Wilson with the works of Shakespeare, and not just Shakespeare, Chekhov, Sam Shepard, because writes about real people in real human situations, like Kafka and Dostoevsky, you know, people who are suffering, the human experience. When August would sign an autograph, he would often sign his name and then right beneath it, the struggle continues. That's what he wrote on my jitney script when he read with us, the struggle continues. I don't know where it is, it's in storage somewhere, but I have it. And it's just something else. And as you can see that it's a big, big part of who I am as an artist, as an actor. Now, on other walls, I have posters from shows from Bricka Lodge, from the Public Theater, from City Theater, and Lord knows who else. But it's August's work that had really turned the corner for me in my career. And doing that, the 10, now I'm not the only actor in the world to have 10. Of August Wilson's plays under my belt. There are actors who have done the 10 plays, and there are other actors who have done the one-man show, How I Learned What I Learned. Now, of those actors that had done How I Learned What I Learned, I am the only one who done the 10. So that's, you know, my little distinction. I like it. And it sometimes feel like standing at the apex, at the summit, and saying, yeah, yeah. And you look back and say, wow. And you're like, well, I'm kind of old. You got a little old there. So that's part of the experience of that I have experienced. I mean, I've experienced things in August Wilson's work that other actors just haven't. Like when, I mean, I had no idea that doing the work of August Wilson, I was going to have Denzel Washington sitting right in front of me as I perform a monologue from How I Learned What I Learned. And it was about August's mother and a washing machine that she worked her behind off to get, and August, as a young boy, broke it. But Denzel was there, and during this ceremony, there were all these dignitaries there. It was at the August Wilson House, and Denzel had gotten together with Oprah, with Tyler Perry, Antoine Fuqua, and a few others, and got them to chip in some money to donate $5 million to the August Wilson House. And that was just so awesome. So with this ground blessing ceremony, I got to do this monologue. Now, this particular day, as soon as the ceremony started, it started raining. And it rained for about 20, 25 minutes into, it was about time for me to do my monologue in the rain. And just as they called me, stopped. Sun peeked through. I did my monologue, had my moment when Denzel shook his hand, cameras, shutters going crazy. And I'm like, get out. What is going on here? And then as soon as I took my seat back over there, it started raining again. And I'm like, that's August. That ain't nothing but August. That ain't nobody but August. And there's so many moments like that. Now, of any of you guys out there, because I'm running out of gas a little bit, has anybody got any questions for me? Anybody?
Hi there.
Hi.
Yeah, I had to turn my microphone on. No, it's fascinating. We got a few questions. And I want to pick up on some of the things you said about this. The first, which came in Gail, which is, which, you know, you've played all the plays, you've done the one-man show. Which of the characters was the most difficult to play?
The one most difficult to play, I would say, was Elmore in the play King Hedley II. No, that was not the most. Hedley in Seven Guitars was the most difficult. It was so props oriented. I had to keep up with so many props in that play, Seven Guitars. I had to have cigarettes, boiled eggs, chicken sandwiches. I had to make chicken sandwiches. That means I had to have bags, sell it, wax paper, bread, lunch meat, shells. Oh, I mean, I had to have cigars. I had to have knives. I had to have a machete. I had so many props to keep up with. And any actor knows the least amount of props you got to keep or have, because you got to touch all your props. And trust me, when you got that many props, you go to touch your prop and like, where's my prop? Who's touching my prop? And next thing you know, you're losing your mind.
You have my sympathy, because I did a play by Alan Ayckbourn once, in which I had over 200 different props, including having to do a puppet show on stage. I know how you felt. Yeah, I can get that. Here's another one. Is there a role that that you wish you could play in a Wilson play, but you can't because like age or gender or what have you?
Oh yeah, first Levy in Ma Rainey's Black Bottom.
Yeah,
I got involved in theater just at Levy age, but I didn't have the Levy seasoning, and so now I'm a little too old to do that. I had just squeezed in Boy Willie in 2015, but yeah, it would be Levy because he's the young upstart in Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, and his dialogue is just thunderous. It's his character is just so angry, volcanic.
Talking about the dialogue, let's go back to because you said something which I'm delighted you said, because I spent a whole program about it last week talking about this. You know that what makes something classic is its and therefore and universal is its specificity, that it is about a place, a time, a group of people, and you know, if it is true of its time and of its place, that's what makes it classic, because it's therefore true of all time and all place. And you talked about, right at the beginning, you were talking about, you know, when you started to read Wilson's plays, when the first time you did it, this was your mother talking, this was your friends talking, that you yes. heard, you heard the words that you lived in.
Oh yeah, it embraced, it
you know, he was born
the familiarity, on the familiarity of it. I mean, like, if it's like if you're from the Bronx and you hear a guy say, "Go wait in the car, what's the matter with you?" You know? You know, and you hear that, like, yeah, I know that guy. I know that guy. He lives on 38th Street. I know that guy. and that draws you in. It just draws you right in.
Because I always felt that, you know, that Wilson's plays for Pittsburgh are a bit like O'Casey's plays for Dublin. Even though they were, you know, they're not modern Dublin, they're old Dublin, but there is still a universality about the nature of the characters, because as Wilson said to you, you write what you know, and O'Casey yes. wrote what he knew, what he heard. So would you describe Wilson as the authentic voice of the Hill as it was?
Oh, definitely. Most definitely. And throughout the 20th century, because not a whole lot had changed up until he gets into the 80s, the 70s, the 80s. But well, pretty much the first century. But I say his the things remained constant up until Two Trains Running. And that was with where they addressed the death of Malcolm X, Dr. King, and this charlatan preacher. He's like Reverend Ike. They called him Prophet Samuel. And you know, it was a change, a turn. And it was when Memphis goes to Aunt Esther. You don't see her, but he talks about his experience with her. And the other older fella, Holloway, which was, when I did it, was brilliantly played by Salahuddin. He was Holloway. He just was. And that was a turning point, like with Memphis, like with the beginning of the regentrification of the Hill District. It was like the beginning of it that was noticeable, that they really started feeling. And then the next decade, Jitney, they really started feeling it. And then in the 80s, you got King Headley II, which things were just destitute. And then you got, in the 90s, you got Radio Golf with this black man running for mayor, but the characters in there saying the Hill District is dead.
Yeah.
You can't bring it back.
The destruction of the Hill District, you know, because of the building of the arena and all of that. How severe, in terms of the art, in terms of writing, in terms of artists, because it wasn't just Wilson, there were musicians and there were, you know, singers. For those who are not, of our listeners who are not Pittsburghers, how severe was that damage to the Hill?
Well,
culturally,
I gotta say, and a lot of older Pittsburghers will agree with me that, it was integration that started that. That once black people were allowed to shop downtown and go here and go there, they abandoned their own. When the Negro Leagues, when Jackie Robinson got put in the National Leagues, put in the major leagues, it was the slow death of the Negro Leagues. And the Negro Leagues, It was part of the ecosystem of the black community. It's the economic backbone in a lot of ways. You know, people made money, people came into town, people spent money in the Hill District.
Yeah.
But once the integration thing happened.
Well, it was where you went. I mean, it was the jazz center. I mean, it was one of the three or four jazz centers of America. I mean, you went to the Hill.
Yes.
For that.
And that was the last bastion. That was the last bastion of prosperity in the Hill District. Places like the Hurricane Club with Miss Bertie Dunlap, which I was writing a story about her. She's something else. She was a madam. And, oh my goodness, the stories. And my uncle had played on the Pittsburgh Steelers around the time I was born, around 62, 63. And then he went to play for Cleveland. But during the time he was here, my uncle didn't drink. He was a total teetotaler. But he had some stories about some of them Steelers that would come to a game drunk. The quarterback, Bobby Lane, and they would have been hanging out at the Hurricane or Crawford Grill all night long.
Let's get back to August Wilson, though. Can we? One of the most intriguing things, again, for those who don't know his work, that he wrote 10 plays, one for each decade of the 20th century. Do you think that the plays themselves truly represent the Pittsburgh, and particularly the African-American community in Pittsburgh, in each of those decades? I mean, how well do you think he succeeded? And I know, I mean, nobody admires his works more than you do, but how well do you think he succeeded in representing that the evolution specifically of the Hill District, because that was pretty much where everything belonged. How well do you think he succeeded?
I think he succeeded to an extent, and I think there's only so much of an extent that he could succeed without ceasing to be a playwright.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And and just being a historian.
Yeah.
That you still got to have that wistful aura to a play, that I don't know what's going to happen, you know, thing of a play. And you don't let, a person told me before, you don't let the truth or history get in the way of telling a good story.
Yes, it's an old Irish saying, never spoil a good story by telling the truth.
Yeah, oh, that's it. Yeah. Yeah. So he had to, he couldn't get but so historic, per se, in his thing. Like Seven Guitars, my goodness. Seven Guitars, they say a few times in the play that it's taking place in 1948. But they're listening to the second fight between Joe Louis and the white kid, the Pittsburgh kid. I forget his last name. But that fight actually happened in 46. You know, and we're actually listening to the fight, you know, and with Don Dunphy, you know, this and that. I did the voiceover one year, for the ring announcer, but you know, he doesn't let it get in the way. He's dealing with the decade,
yeah,
in each of his plays,
yeah.
So it kind of generalizes and seeks, you know, a little specificities, you know, because he'll give it a specific year, like Jitney 77, Two Trains 69, you know, Fences 57, you know, and so on and so forth. So he'll give little generalizations of it, but he stays focused on that story.
Obviously in Pittsburgh, I mean, you know, but in America, he is known as, you know, one of the great classic voices of black theater, black drama in America. Mm-hmm. How well do you think, I mean, I got my opinions, but how well do you think that the plays would translate abroad? How well, in your knowledge, have they?
Well, it's funny you should mention that, because I've seen his 10 plays in Japanese, in Russian. And I thought to myself, I would love to see Jitney in Osaka. I would love to see it in Manila. You know, I would love to see it, you know, I mean, in other languages too. And when I would do workshops with Mark Southers, with kids and whatnot, these acting workshops, I would elaborate on how universal his stories are, and in the action, you know, the conflict are always universal, that anybody can identify with, to the point where I did a monologue in the voice of Jason Statham, the actor. And I was like, I'm going to tell you how I see it. The only thing that makes that piano worth something is them carvings over there.
This is my point. I completely agree, because I would love to see them done in Dublin. Just right. as much as I would love to see the O'Casey play, and we will be doing some done here, because, but with the voices, with the author, it's like people, when I talk about Shakespeare, people often say, well, you know, should we do British accents? No, you do it in your own, voice. You find your own voice in the words. And I think this Wilson's plays are so wonderfully written, and the characters, as you say, are so wonderfully authentic that they are recognizable anywhere. We did a couple of plays of an Irish folk dramatist, John B. Keane, and these plays are set in the west of Ireland in the early part of the 20th century. They are very authentically Irish peasant drama, and I said I could do it and set it in Appalachia.
Sure, I
could set it somewhere in central China, because they're about those people. But what you don't do is you don't have actors pretending to be what they're not.
You lose the conflict.
That's it. That's exactly it. You know,
you lose the action.
Tell me, somebody asked, could you speak about some of the young actors that you've mentored through August Wilson's work?
Well, oh my goodness, I tell you what, one of my recent favorite young actors is a fellow, he does work with the Pittsburgh Public. He's Malik Mott.
Yes.
And when we did, you know him, yeah.
He's one of ours as well.
See, that's what I'm talking about. You guys know. He's such a trooper that when we did Ma Rainey's Black Bottom a couple of years ago, Pittsburgh Playwright, he played Sylvester. And we were eating these sandwiches, and one of them made him kind of sick. And during the scenes he wasn't in, he was on the balcony throwing up, you know, choking his guts out. And I was thinking to myself, if a sandwich made me sick like that, I'd be going home. I would be going. He came right back out there on that stage and he performed at peak level. And I said, boy, you done. You touch my heart. He's a trooper. Mm-hmm. He's the real true blue, real deal. I love him.
He did some Shakespeare for us, and he's it's wonderful. I mean, it's really important that actors like yourself do mentor these young people, because you can go to theater school, you can learn all the things, but you do need that association with someone with prior experience to help you through that. A couple of other questions here. Did August Wilson talk about how, where, and why Aunt Esther originated?
Well, he never talked to me about how he originated her, but the origins that I've heard in the sewing circles and the campfires are that she was supposed to have been born in 1619, and she was supposed to had, because in Gem of the Ocean, they have the bill of sale for her, and she makes Caesar read it. And then it's kind of like Zorro, you know, that she trains the next Don Esther. And that next Aunt Esther starts out as Black Mary. And then, so there's a new Black Mary, there's a new Aunt Esther, and like Zorro, it just keeps going in succession. He's never really spoken to me too much about who she is. Now, she's kind of based on this lady who was the first Black registered nurse in the Hill District. And this lady's name was Miss Sarah Degree. And people would go to her house. She had a specific door. It wasn't red per se, but people would go see her on Tuesdays. Those were the days that she wasn't working at the hospital. And there were people who would come see her that could not be seen at the hospital. And there was no clinic and stuff like that. And Miss Sarah, she would do root teas, goodie packets, and all those little homeopathic remedies and whatnot. So she's kind of based on her, and with a little, you know, pizzazz that August just adds in with.
Well, I find it wonderful because, you know, we who live in Pittsburgh know, I mean, the Hill District is a relatively small area, and yet it seems from Wilson's plays that it was absolutely jam-packed with this wonderful range of characters. But that's almost true of any, I've always had this theory that there are no such thing as cities. There are just combinations of villages. You know, and Pittsburgh is a great example of that because it's a
yes.
city of neighborhoods.
Yes, definitely.
With a very small downtown central area. But the Hill, through all the years that he wrote about, even the ones he didn't even live in, it was a village. And full, there's a question actually was asked on that topic, that the Hill, the whole jazz aspect of it, was the place where legends were slayed. What did that, do you know that one?
No, I don't.
I think it has to do with the fact that if you thought you were a good jazz musician, you went and played the Hill, you'd find out whether you were good or not.
Oh yeah, that was for real.
But there are theaters like that as well.
Yes, stand-up comedy.
Yep.
Oh,
God. There's another. I'm looking at questions that are coming up. There was another one there that forgive me because I'm not doing my job properly. I'm listening to you instead of checking what's on the page. Why did you? So you mentioned that Elmore was a difficult role. Why do you think that was? Why was it difficult?
Well, just because I didn't like him. I just didn't like him. There's a few August Wilson characters that I didn't like as characters, but I don't allow it to affect me. A lot of times, if I hate the character, I'm going to do twice as good as that character if I don't like him, you know? And Elmore, he's a shyster. He's what they called in back in the day, a Stagger Lee sort of, you know, in and out of jail, sort of hustler. He'll shoot you in a minute over 50 cents. Yeah, he was that kind of dude. And he killed this fella named Leroy, who was the father of old Joe. Who's the father of King Headley. Okay, he's the father of King Headley, and Elmore comes in getting back with King Headley's mother. Now, they told Headley, who was in Seven Guitars, Ruby did when she was younger, that this child was his, but it actually belonged to this fella named Leroy in Alabama that when Elmore killed Leroy in a jealous rage, she went on up to Pittsburgh pregnant but not showing. So she hooks up with Headley in Seven Guitars, has King Headley the Second. Okay, and it goes from there. But King finds out that it was Elmore that killed his father. He finds out who his father really was, then finds out Elmore killed him. And then Ruby goes to shoot Elmore, and she winds up shooting King Headley the Second. And, you know, I'm like, Elmore, he still gets to walk around eating and starting his trouble. It's like, sometimes the bad guy doesn't always, you know, get his up and coming.
But aren't the bad guys more fun to play, though? I mean,
I was having fun.
I played a few myself, and, you know.
Yeah, I did have fun. It was a guilty.
Yeah, pleasure. You know, there's a joy in being evil now, yeah. Especially when, like you and me, we are basically saints. And
yeah, sure.
Yeah, there's a lot of fun. if you were to say to young people, but not just actors, but anybody, people who don't know, to talk about Wilson and to learn about him as a writer and why he's important. As we say, there are 10 plays there. Where would you start? Would you start at the beginning and go through them chronologically, or would you say, go and read this one first? How would you approach that?
Geez, that's a good question, because there are some of the plays that will, that I would suggest they don't read first. And in the first one, I would suggest they don't read first is King Hedley II, mainly because of how really dark and sad it is. It's so sad. Everybody in the play loses out. And that's theater. You're not going to have a sugar-coated, squishy, sweet, happy ending all the time, So I would tell them not to start there. If I was to tell them the first one to read, I'd tell them to read Jitney.
That was the first one I read, but go on.
Yeah, that was the first one I saw, too. The first August Wilson play that I saw. And it was there that I had met Anthony Chisholm. And Lord knows, I had no idea that in a couple of years I would be performing in two trains running with Anthony Chisholm. He was on HBO's Oz. And he just did Jim of the Ocean like a couple of years ago with Felicia Rashad on Broadway. And I'm like, oh, wow. So I had to thank my buddy, Mr. Mark Southers, in Pittsburgh Playwrights Theater. And I'm glad that I put in the work. Now, I put in some work at Pittsburgh Playwrights. You bet your bottom dollar I did for 20 years.
Yeah.
20 years. And we made some magic happen. We made some serious magic happen in the last two decades. So
you have, indeed.
I'm pretty much in the Wali Jamal business now.
Well, yeah, but no. In fact, the work, the work that's been done here in Pittsburgh on it's quite right that there should be representative performances of Wilson's work here in Pittsburgh on a regular basis. That's only right and just.
I'll give you that because for the last 3 years, I had been performing August Wilson's one-man show, How I Learned What I Learned, at the August Wilson Center for his birthday. And I was supposed to perform it this year in March for the August Wilson Society, but with the corona, that's when things just first started getting shut down. And but they did reschedule it, and I will be performing it at the August Wilson Center come this April.
Yeah, great, wonderful. That also, as a piece, is a great introduction to Wilson, not just historically, not just, what he did and how he lived and all of that. Because, one-man shows about people tend to be what you mentioned earlier, it's not about it's not a historical document, but it is a great introduction, not just to what he did, but who he was. And I mean, who he was inside, not who he was, the playwright, but the person, the way he would approach questions of color, the way he would approach questions of society. Would you agree that if you're going to say to something about learn about August Wilson, hand them that one-man show and say, read that?
Oh, yeah. It reveals so much about him, the man himself. And his views on life, his views on race, his views on America. The man loves America.
Yeah.
And it's without a doubt, he loves America. He doesn't love how America treats certain people. And he speaks about it, and he should not be felt incongenial by speaking his mind about it. And people have a problem with it. And those are the people that he addresses, because it's not that they're wrong, it's that they are not trying to understand that there are people who have been conditioned to think themselves superior, just as so many of us have been conditioned to think ourselves inferior. We've been worked on. the black people have been worked on just as the white people have been worked on. These white people who are, you know, doing these silly things, you know, they're calling the police because somebody's barbecuing, stuff like that. You know, that's part of conditioning too. You know, and we have to meet and like shed these things together and get on the same page.
The great Irish politician John Hume, who died a week ago and was instrumental in bringing peace to Northern Ireland more than any other Irish politician, and a quite remarkable man. But he made the point that most conflict in the world, be it major wars or street fights, are caused by one thing and one thing only: difference.
Yeah.
The fact that we look at difference, and if we look at similarity, most conflict disappears. And yep. I think Wilson actually, I mean, I'm no expert on Wilson by any means, and that's why you're doing these programs, not me. But it does strike me that Wilson's philosophy was to understand similarity, because he himself, like all of us, none of us are pure in that sense.
Are
pure. You know, I have German blood in me, and I have Irish, and I have English, whatever that is, because nobody quite knows what English is. Scottish, I think. Wilson was black, but he was also part German, and he was, you know, he understood the fact that it was about similarity, not difference, that makes the world work best. And I think that's expressed, I mean, I'm no authority on the plays, but it does strike me that that is also an expression within the way he wrote.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Similarities, definitely. It kind of rings true. I mean, even with the differences, like in Gem of the Ocean, or better still, Joe Turner's Come and Gone, where there's a character, one of the only white, the only recurring white character, Rutherford Seelig, and he's referred to as the people finder. But he's a peddler of merchandise, of pots, pans, you know, he's got the wagon, you know, and he's in the plays from 1904 and 1911. And when he sits there with the African-Americans and he's having a biscuit and some coffee, they are talking. And they're talking, you know, not somewhat political, somewhat, but it's them talking, it's people talking, not politicians talking. It's regular people affected by, you know, these policies and whatnot, that that they're really talking and commiserating.
Yeah. Okay, Wally, we're coming to the end of our time. For those of you out there listening to us, we will be back here next week, same time, same bat time, same bat channel. We'll be back. Wally and I will be talking more about Wilson. And for those of you who missed this or want to look at it again, it will be available on the conversation will be, like all our webinars, available on our website. Go to PICT website and PICT Educates, and you'll find it. Sorry, my colleague in the other room is going into hysterics for some reason or other. But anyway, so it'll all be available. You can watch it again. Wally, you and I will be back together next week. Thank you for being with us this week.
All right. Thank you for having me.
Viewing. I hope you enjoyed that conversation. If you don't know about August Wilson, I hope it's whetted your appetite. Go read the plays. If you can get the script for the one-man show, it is a great introduction to who he was and what he represents. Because as I think we both agree, if there are classic American playwrights, and we all keep thinking of you know, from O'Neill and Albee and Mamet and the rest, August Wilson is not only up there with them, he's leading a lot of that pack in the way he wrote, in the way he understood human nature and the way people interact with one another, and how any society develops over a long period of time. So they are wonderful plays. I'm thrilled that you were there. For every of you listening, as I say, you are free to come and sponsor one of our webinars. We will have them every single week for the rest of time. until the crack of doom. So we're always going to be here, except at Christmas and New Year. I think they're the two weekends that we won't be here. But apart from that, the other 50 weeks of the year, we're going to be doing a webinar on something. We have a lot coming up. If you wish to sponsor, let us know. Send us an email. If you don't wish to sponsor, but you wish to help, as I always say to you, every dollar helps. We've still got to keep the company running. We are going to be going into production with online presentations over the next few weeks. There'll be more information about that coming up. I'll be telling you about it. It'll also be on the website. Any donation, really, really welcome, no matter how small it is, no matter whether it's in dollars or euros or yen or zloty, we don't mind. Just please make a donation. Small donations, many small donations, fill up the stink just as much as big ones. So please, please consider sending us something. In the meantime, thanks for being with us, and we'll see you all, I hope, with your friends next week, 2 o'clock on Friday. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Okay, how do I get out of here?